So we've seen that the logistic equation with R equals 4 shows the butterfly effect, sensitive dependence on initial conditions. Two imperceptibly different starting points can lead to big differences in the orbits later on. And we saw this by the use of computers. I used a computer to iterate a function or solve a differential equation, and we saw these diverging trajectories. So I argued that this makes these systems, even though they're deterministic, essentially unpredictable because we need impossible accuracy in order to do long-term or often even medium-term prediction. In addition to posing a challenge to our predictions of real processes, it also poses a challenge or a puzzle for how we think about the computer results themselves. Since computers don't store numbers to infinite precision, and that's what we need in order to do an accurate long-term prediction on the computer. We need enormous precision in the starting point and in all the numbers along the way. So given that computers make tiny round-off errors due to how they represent decimals, we might wonder, can we trust the results of computer simulations at all? And the answer turns out to be yes, and there's a nice result that illustrates this, known as the shadowing lemma. So what I want to do in this video is present the basic idea behind the shadowing lemma, partly so you feel a little better about the computer results, but also because it's just a neat result and a fun way and another way to think about what sensitive dependence on initial conditions and chaotic dynamics mean. So here's the idea behind shadowing. Let's say we're studying an iterated function like the logistic equation, and we choose an initial condition, and then we compute. We use a computer to compute an orbit, and we could plot it in a time series plot, just like I was having the computer do. And maybe it looks something like this. So the problem is that the computer is making round-off errors. It doesn't have infinite precision, and so because of sensitive dependence on initial conditions, this computed orbit is not actually the true orbit for the initial condition that we chose. So initially, I'll draw in blue the true orbit for this initial condition. It might start here. It would be close. But then, this is sensitive dependence on initial conditions. The true orbit might depart from the computed orbit. So I wanted the computer to tell me the orbit for this initial condition. And what the computer told me is shown here in this black curve. However, this black curve, the computed orbit, is not the true orbit for this initial condition. The computer makes small round-off errors in how it is storing decimal numbers. And so the computed orbit is not the same as the true orbit. This is another manifestation of the butterfly effect. So at this point, we can ask, if this black curve, this black time series, is not the true orbit, what is it? Does it have any meaning at all? Or is it just garbage, just some sort of randomness? And amazingly, it turns out that this computed orbit does have some meaning. It's the true orbit for some other initial condition. So let me draw kind of a picture of what that might look like, at the risk of clouding this up. Okay, so the black time series is what we computed. The blue is the true orbit for this initial condition. The red is some other true orbit. So this black curve is indeed an orbit of the logistic equation, or whatever it is we're studying. It just happens to not be the exact orbit or the true orbit for the initial condition that I thought, but it's a true orbit for some other initial condition. So I can still interpret this black time series as a trajectory of the logistic equation. It's not garbage, it's not nonsense. It just happens to not be the exact trajectory I maybe thought I was initially studying. So this says that numerical results for at least iterated maps like the logistic equation, even though round-off error, precision in the computer, finite precision in the computer, and the butterfly effect means that this black computed orbit is not true, a faithful representation of the orbit for this initial condition, it's still a faithful representation of an orbit of the logistic equation. So we would say that this computed orbit in black shadows this red orbit. It might not be exactly this a true orbit, but it's arbitrarily close to some true orbit. And this result, that this is true, is known as the shadowing lemma. And a lemma in mathematics is a result that's used as an intermediate step to prove or demonstrate some other central or more important result. In any event, this is a pretty famous result, and it's known as the shadowing lemma, and the phenomenon is shadowing. Shadowing is when a computed orbit, which is in a sense wrong due to the butterfly effect and finite precision, nevertheless shadows, comes arbitrarily close to some other true orbit. So shadowing is, I think, a strange phenomena, and it's fun and interesting to think about. Let me give an analogy to illustrate this idea behind shadowing. So let's say you asked me to draw a portrait of somebody. And as you know, because you've seen me draw, I'm actually not very good at drawing at all. So I try to draw a true, accurate portrait of whomever you've asked me to make a portrait of. But since I'm not very good, I make a little mistake around the eyes, and I make a little mistake around the mouth, and I make a little mistake around the nose. I make a little mistake actually kind of all the time, because I'm just not a very good at drawing. So the result is I hand you a portrait of that I've drawn, and you would look at it and you'd say, that looks nothing like the person you were supposed to be drawing. And I would say, oh yeah, you're right, sorry. But in the shadowing lemma picture, what I've drawn is not an accurate picture of the person I was trying to draw or you wanted me to draw, but nevertheless, what I've drawn is an accurate portrait of somebody else. So I haven't drawn an accurate picture of your friend you wanted a portrait of, but of the 6 or 7 billion people in the world, I got this just very, very close to right for somebody else. So that's the idea behind the shadowing lemma. You ask the computer to not draw a portrait, but make a time series of a particular initial condition. And the computer makes little errors because it just has finite precision. It's certainly better at arithmetic than I am at drawing, but it still has finite precision. And so it hands you back not a portrait, but a time series. And this time series is not exactly what you wanted. It's not the true exact time series for the initial condition, but it is true or arbitrarily close to true, an arbitrarily close to true time series for some other initial condition. So maybe you'd be a little bit disappointed, but nevertheless, what the computer has given you does say something true about the dynamical system you're studying. It is arbitrarily close to a true orbit of the dynamical system. I can't prove the shadowing lemma in this course. It's a pretty technical result, and we just don't have the mathematical machinery to do it. But let me say a few things that maybe will make it seem at least a little bit more plausible. Okay, so let's imagine that the dynamical system we're interested in is not a deterministic iterated function, but is a fair coin, something that's random, that has an element of chance in it. So that just every time you toss the coin, with an equal probability, it comes up heads or tails. And then you asked me to say, okay, what are the next 5 outcomes going to be? So that's, in a sense, the orbit for this system. And I might say, oh, I think it's going to be heads, heads, tails, tails, tails. And then the system ran, and it turns out I was wrong. not surprisingly, it's hard to predict perfectly random fair coin processes. So anyway, so I said heads, heads, tails, 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 and I'm wrong. But then I could say, yeah, all right, I'm wrong, but I'm not totally wrong, because if you wait long enough, you're going to see heads, heads, tails, tails, tails for sure, because all possible outcomes of heads and tails are equally likely. So yeah, I told you a wrong result in this particular instance, but it's true in that you really will see heads, heads, tails, 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 so I'm not as wrong as you think I am. Okay, so that's not a surprising or very deep statement about a random process like tossing coins. But what's interesting is the same sort of argument holds for this deterministic system, an iterated function. So you ask me to predict the next 5 or the next 50 orbits, and I, on my calculator on the computer, give you an answer, and it turns out that that answer is wrong compared to the true orbit, but I could say, yeah, okay, sorry, I got it wrong, but I guarantee you that this, if you wait long enough, you would see this orbit, so I've given you something that's actually true. So in a sense, if a system is random or mixed up enough, then errors made in trying to predict the system in this context can still produce results that could have been produced by the system. And maybe another way to think about this is the things I'm calling errors are not errors in the sense that I forget the rules of arithmetic, or I think that, you know, I think that 2 + 2 = 5. They're just, you know, they're very small imprecisions, and then it's the butterfly effect that amplifies those imprecisions. So in effect, we have these tiny errors, but then the macroscopic manifestation of these errors is a result of the dynamics of the system itself. So in a sense, the errors or imprecisions, I'm not even sure what word to use, arise from the dynamics of the system, not from some horrible blunder or external source. And so maybe it's not surprising that the system-induced errors or imprecisions are nevertheless in some way true to the system. Okay, so again, this is certainly not a proof of the phenomenon of shadowing, but maybe these remarks help to make shadowing seem a little bit more plausible. And as maybe you could tell in the last couple of minutes, there are different notions of randomness that might be appearing here. Is a process random if it's made by a random process? Can a deterministic process have a random outcome? So there's some ideas that would want to unpack here and think more carefully about what one means when one says something is random. So this will be the topic, what is randomness and how do we think about it in dynamical systems, of the next set of lectures.